Good morning and welcome. I welcome you to this special time of worship, a special time in my life. It is my last service here. When I announced my retirement, it seemed like a long way away, and now it's really here. And so, hard to believe, all sorts of nerves involved now, and I really appreciate your presence here to be part of the service, to remember what we've shared and celebrate that, and also to wish each other well. So I welcome you to this service. As the first song indicated, we are an open and affirming congregation, and throughout the time I've been here, we've tried to welcome all. So I do remind you that here at First Church, that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And normally we'd have a time of greeting, but with the COVID, we have relaxed restrictions so that we just say if you are fully vaccinated, masks are optional. We encourage you to wear masks if you're not vaccinated. So, and because of that, we don't move around a lot. We try to keep social distance as much as possible as well. So I'm going to invite you, rather than moving around for each other, just stand and turn around and wave or nod or somehow acknowledge the people that have come to worship with you so that you can greet them here. And you may be seated. We now turn our hearts and minds to what we came for, which is the worship of God, and I invite you to center your hearts and minds in God's presence as we listen to the music of the prayer.
Thank you.
And I invite you to stand as we read responsively our call to worship. Come, give to the Lord your praises of thanksgiving.
We come this day grateful for God's wondrous gifts to us.
Sing with great enthusiasm of God's mighty power and love.
We celebrate that love that frames our lives.
It is a wonderful thing to praise God.
May God's praise always be in our hearts and in our lives. Amen.
And I invite you to remain standing and to sing with the band as you are able. This next song is Green God's Dream. It was written by Brian Sergio, who's a United Church of Christ minister, who's also a classmate of mine at Duke. Although we didn't know each other there, we had mutual friends, and he wrote this song for a celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So Green God's Dream.
Thank you.
I invite you to join me in the opening prayer as you find it in your bulletin. Let us pray. God of secret purposes and extravagant blessings, we come to praise you. We come because we want to. We sing our songs because we are glad to. We pray for your grace because we need to. And we ask for the love of Christ in our hearts because without it, we are a dead loss. Please lift every shutter within our mind and open every door within our soul that you, the Lord of glory, the God of countless hosts, may come in through Christ Jesus, the joy of loving hearts. Amen. And I do invite children to join me at the front of this time. A lot of kids and a lot of players. Here, I'm just going to open one of these, and it's going to be this one. And if I can get it out of the container, you can make all sorts of things with Play-Doh, can't you? And you can use it for several different things, like if I take this quarter and I press it into the Play-Doh, what kind of shape do you think you'll see? Can you hold it enough shape? Little circle. Maybe you can see a little bit of George Washington's head there. Sometimes it leaves the print of what you press in, right? So you'll see a print there. Other times you can use something like this and press mold into it and make it almost like a cookie cutter, right? And then what shape is this? It's a dolphin, that's right. So we have a dolphin swimming around. And you can do that. So there's different shapes. There's some factory kind of things you can do with Play-Doh too, right? You can make different shapes and build buildings with them or do all sorts of things. And you shape it and you mold it to what you want to use it for and what you're using it for and what you'd like it to look like. So that's a nice thing. It fits your imagination, right? And so you can use your imagination to make it the things that you want. Well, we have, our lives are shaped by different things. Not by us with our hands that we do with Play-Doh, but our lives are shaped by our families, our parents. They help shape us and make us who we are. Your lives may be shaped by your teachers at school. Your lives may be shaped by your friends that you have at school or that you play with, your brothers and sisters. Are all things that make you who you are. And the experiences that you have growing up and as you get older help make you who you are. And all these things shape you. They may not make you into a dolphin form, but they shape you and make you, each of you, different. Not just the way you look, but who you are is different because you're shaped by all these things. Well, all different shapes that we're made into, God can use. To do God's word, to spread God's love to the people around us and to the people in need. So hopefully, as you think about how you're growing and what you're changing and how you're becoming older and more responsible, that you'll think about how God might use you, how God might want to use you to make other people know that they are special and that they're loved, just like you are special and you're loved. Okay? So I hope you remember that God helps shape your life as well as this congregation, as your parents, teachers, your friends. And everybody can have a container of Play-Doh. So if you want to pick one, everybody got one? You can go back and sit with your family. And thanks for coming. It is so good to hear the choir. The last time I heard them was before COVID. Since we came back to worship after COVID, they normally take the summer off, so they haven't been singing. So I'm really honored that they made this special appearance today, and really thrilled that they are part of the service today. I haven't heard them in every September, when September ends and they come back, I'm always thrilled then. That has been so much longer. As you can tell, hopefully you can tell by the end of the service, music means a lot to me, and there's a lot of music in the service, and the choir just completes it, and so I'm so glad that you're here today for that. Our scripture lesson today is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, the 8th chapter, and I read you the first 9 verses. So Paul wrote to the church there in Corinth, "Now, friends, I want to report on the surprising and generous ways in which God is working in the churches in Macedonia province. Fierce troubles came down on the people of those churches, pushing them to the very limit. The trial exposed their true colors. They were incredibly happy, though desperately poor. The pressure triggered something totally unexpected, an outpouring of pure and generous gifts. I was there and saw it for myself. They gave offerings of whatever they could, far more than they could afford, pleading for the privilege of helping out in the relief of poor Christians. This was totally spontaneous, entirely their own idea, and caught us completely off guard. What explains it was that they had first given themselves unreservedly to God and to us. The other giving simply flowed out of the purposes of God working in their lives. That's what prompted us to ask Titus to bring the relief offering to your attention, so that what was so well begun could be finished up. You do so well in so many things. You trust God, you're articulate, you're insightful, you're passionate, you love us. Now, do your best in this too. I'm not trying to order you around against your will, but by bringing in the Macedonians' enthusiasm as a stimulus to your love, I am hoping to bring the best out of you. You are familiar with the generosity of our Master, Jesus Christ. Rich as he was, he gave it all away for us. In one stroke, he became poor, and we became rich. This is the word of God for you, God's people. Amen." Through the month of June, I reflected on a lot of experiences of myself through my 39 years of ministry and where I have seen God's Spirit working and acting. Today, I want to switch it around a little bit and take a moment to reflect on where I've seen God's Spirit working in you and in our community, and how that I have appreciated that and witnessed that. I had a professor in a seminary called Dr. John Westerhoff, and he was an Episcopal priest. He was nationally known for his work in Christian education, and that's why that was the concentration I had as a major in seminary. And so I took just about every course he gave. And one of the courses he gave, and he didn't limit himself just to your basic Christian education. He kind of touched on everything and said, it's all Christian education, so I can pretty much teach whatever I want. And one of the courses he taught was Pastor of Spiritual God. And had us thinking about our own spiritual lives and how we share that with others. And during the course of that, he had one little tidbit that stuck with me through the years. I don't know that I even shared it here, but I shared it at other churches, and people kind of got a chuckle out of it, but they kind of kept it around too and keep reminding us reminding each other of this. But his teaching in this Pastor of Spiritual Guide course was, he says, "I don't pray for patience." He says, "Because if you pray for patience, God gives you things that will teach you patience. And I don't want those things." He says, "So I pray for corollary to that now, that if you meet a patient person, they must have been shaped by those experiences that are trying, that maybe test them and their endurance. They have experienced things where they had to develop that, if you will, that patient muscle to have that. So not only do you not pray for it so that you don't get sent those things, but if you meet somebody that's got that characteristic, I think it's true that perhaps they had the experience in their past that has made them a patient person. As I come here to Willimantic 10 and a half years ago, Willimantic already had a reputation that wasn't very good. And I think, as I discovered, that it was an undeserved reputation. It was partly because of a news broadcast. I think it was 60 Minutes. They gave it a title, and I'm not even going to repeat it because I don't think it's correct. It's not what I've experienced here. But on the other hand, I think there is a lot of need here in Willimantic. There is a lot of need. There are people that need help and are looking for help. And you might just think, well, you know, it's a very poor, it's a very needy community, and there is that aspect to it. But I think, like, those trying experiences build patient people, that when people are confronted with this need, when they see it here in our community, what I found is it builds a very generous people. That's the characteristic I would say that this wider community of Willimantic has, is it is a very generous community. There are so many places that you can receive and go to for help here. There's the Windham Area Interfaith Ministry, and there's a lot of folks here that are affiliated with that, from Victoria to Carol and Andy on the board. Shirley was on the board for so many years, Randy at the voting docks, Brady, who's been working on the law. So many people are touched by it. And then, of course, it touches this congregation too, because as I understand, there was a clothing closet here that kind of morphed and developed and grew until Wayne was formed. And there are some first generation people from Wayne here as well. Reverend Duvall, my predecessor, and Father Larry, who were instrumental in forming Wayne those years ago. And that is one of the places where the community's generosity is played out day in and day out. And I was honored to be a part of that board for many years, and was one of the best experiences of my life. There's the Covenant Soup Kitchen right across the street for those that need a meal. There's evening meals served at First Baptist Church. There's the No Free Shelter that provides shelter for those in need. And not only that, but is working avidly to find housing for those that are homeless as well. All of these agencies that are there to help meet the need that is real in our community. But what is amazing is the generosity. There was a story that was told to me, and I can't say that I know it firsthand, but it was told to me that there were a group of students at UConn who thought they would come down to Willimantic and serve sandwiches to the hungry people on the street. And so they made their peanut butter jelly sandwiches and came down here and sat out on the street to serve them. Nobody wanted them. Their needs had already been met at the Covenant Soup Kitchen at First Baptist Church. There wasn't a need here like that because of the generosity of this community. It is wonderful. And I think it has been shaped by the need that we do see around us. That need is there, but God has formed a generous people to meet that need, and we celebrate that. And I think we kind of reflect that scripture, as Paul is saying, the churches in Galatia were dirt poor, but they gave everything they had and more to an offering for the poor Christians in Jerusalem. Now he's challenging the Corinthian church to do like them. And I think it's true that the community here that is so generous is probably experienced that here in this congregation. Again, talking about the clothing closet, then expanded to a community program, the Interfaith Sewing Group that does so much work, and was here long before I was, and was just a great community of mostly women who have come together to use their talents to make school bags and health kits to use for Church World Service and send them all over the country. That other churches can put those together. They've sent baptismal gowns to Haiti. They've done so many different things, and it is such a wonderful group, and that's another demonstration of the generosity of this community and of this congregation. The shops that we now have, the Kids Boutique and the thrift shop downstairs that sell clothes on Saturdays, it's just a great ministry to those that can come here and find affordable clothing, get it with dignity, and find a nice welcome here as they come to shop. And so those two are a demonstration of the generosity. Our hosting of the Connecticut Food Bank truck here on a monthly basis. We were one of the few programs that continued to do that throughout the COVID shutdown. And the dedication of our volunteers to keep it going. And the cooperative work of that, that not only did we have members of our congregation participating in that, but members of other congregations, and we were hosted by St. Joseph's Church because our parking lot was too small to be a drive-through event. Again, all these examples, everywhere you look around us, you might see the need, but if you look a little further, you'll see the generosity. We have been formed. We have been molded. And I commend this congregation again. We had a group experience at a Lenten study where we did a study of different faiths. Rabbi Jeremy came in the first week and told us about Judaism. The second week, we went to the mosque when it was still up on Main Street here. Ahmed Kagbar gave us an explanation about Islam. And then we were able to stay there and witness their evening prayer as the men had their community prayer there. And it was just such a great experience. And they were so graceful in welcoming us into that community and letting us witness that and to learn with them. And we as a community, those that went with me for that study, were so graceful as well in accepting it and being honored by it and learning from it. That I think it was that experience that laid the foundation and became the groundwork, made the environment for the formation of our Greater Wyndham Area Interfaith Working Group. And it started from that. Oh, it's good to be together with other faiths and we can learn from one another. And from that experience grew this wider group as well. So I just want to commend you for being such wonderful people, for welcoming me into such a wonderful community where people are just generous beyond their means. And I am honored to have been a part of it. I hope God will continue to form us, that we may be the people that go out on God's behalf to meet the world in its need. Amen. Thank you. move into our liturgy of farewell. I'm going to invite my wife Karen to come up and stand with me. Tim Rod's coming up as representative of our congregation, and Reverend Liz will be on the screen as representative of the Association of the Conference. And Carl Sanders is our photographer for today, so I want to just thank him and explain why he might be moving around. But we do thank him for recording this work.
People come and go, babies are born, children grow up, people commit themselves to one another. Loved ones and friends among us come to the end of their lives. Individuals move into our community and church life. Others leave us, grow toward new places, new experiences, new opportunities. It is important and right that we recognize these times of passage, of endings and beginnings. Today, we share a farewell with our pastor, Reverend Hugh, and our parent.
We give thanks to God for the ways you have welcomed us, supported our family, and journeyed with us as disciples of Christ. We pray for God's blessing upon you.
To you, the members and friends of First Congregational Church of Willimantic, release the Reverend Rick Haverly from the duties of pastor as First Congregational Church of Willimantic.
We do, with the help of God.
Do you offer him your encouragement as his life and ministry unfold in new ways?
We do, with the help of God.
And to you, Rick, release the First Congregational Church of Willimantic from turning to you and depending upon you.
I do, with the help of God.
Do you offer your encouragement to the continuing ministry here and on the relationship with another who will come to serve?
I do, with the help of God.
On behalf of the Willimantic Association of the Southern New England Conference of the United Church of Christ, I witness with gratitude and faith to the words spoken here, words of thankfulness, forgiveness, and release. The member churches of our association and the conference hold each of you in prayer. And we pledge and covenant our support in the transitions signified in this service. Let us pray.
Having heart trouble, and we pray for him as well.
Prayers for my former sister-in-law, Allison Ware, passed away last week.
We pray for Allison on her death, that God will receive her, and also for her family and friends as they grieve. Let's be in spirit of prayer, shall we? Almighty God, we are grateful for your call on our lives. We are grateful for this congregation and community of faith that shapes us, that encourages us on our walk through life, that works with us in many tasks that you have placed before us, and that holds us when we stumble or need help. We give thanks for our wider community and all the generosity that is demonstrated here. That you have shaped us to the needs of this community and offered us as a gift to others, that they too may know your love through the love that we express and the help that we seek to give. May you continue to bless us and help us grow. May you continue to enlighten us, that we may see the path that you have laid out for us, and that we may see where you have called us to be in service, that we may follow faithfully. We pray for those that we have named that are struggling with health. We ask your healing presence to surround them, build them up, carry them through these difficult days. We pray for those that have died. May you receive them into your heavenly kingdom, that they may know your presence and your love face to face. We pray for our nation as well, for those that struggle around us. For the leadership, we ask that you give wisdom and guidance. For those that are dealing with natural disasters, for collapsing buildings, for floods, for droughts, we ask for relief from these, that they may also find a wider extended community that offers gifts and help for their trying needs. Oh God, we give thanks for this day, for the love which you hold us, for the grace that surrounds us. And now in the silence, we offer our own personal prayers of joy or concern. God, we pray these and all things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we pray boldly now as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we do celebrate communion today as we share this meal, come to table to break bread with one another. We share the meal of the community of Christ. Ours is an open communion, all seeking the presence of Christ are welcome to receive communion. We remember in this meal, as Jesus shared it at his parting with his disciples at his Last Supper, preparing them for his absence, that Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, O God. He broke it and he gave it to them and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this as often as you eat it, in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of Christ, we offer you this bread. And with it, remember and are reminded that we are part of one body of Christ. We remember that after the supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to you, O God. He gave it to his disciples and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so we offer this cup as a reminder of our own relationship with God, the forgiveness that we receive in Christ. COVID has made everything different, so the deacons will be moving amongst you, and one deacon will have a tray of bread, and we invite you to take a piece of bread from that. Another deacon will be following with a tray of small cups. You may take a small cup. If you don't want to receive communion, just hold your hand up and let them know that you will not be receiving today. There is bread. There are also gluten-free wafers for those that would like that as well. And what else do I need to say about that? All the rubrics for how to do this. You can take the bread right away and then take the cup when you get it. You can hold them and take them together. Take them as is comfortable for you. You are God's guests at Christ's table here as we come to receive these gifts of grace. While we are receiving communion, the band will be singing Come to the Feast. Again, it's a song written by Christopher Grundy, who's another United Church of Christ minister, who also teaches worship and music at the seminary in St. Louis as well. And so they will be singing Come to the Feast. I will be anointing members of the kneeler on this side. I haven't done that since before COVID. I will be masked to do that, but if you will afford me that privilege. So after you have received communion, if you would like to be anointed, you're invited to come forward to the kneeler and either stand or kneel there, and I will be there. All is prepared, ministering to you in Christ's name, we offer you these gifts. Thank you. Almighty God, we give thanks for these gifts shared here, for the binding together in faith and in the presence of Christ, for the binding together of life, both here and when we're apart, throughout the distance and throughout the ages. May we know that it is your love that brings us together and also sends us out. We rejoice in your presence in this holy meal. Amen. Can I invite you to stand for the song as we sing your response? Again, it reflects the intaking of God's grace that we receive here and the releasing of God's grace that we give in praise as well.
Thank you.
And as we go, may it be God's extravagant love that finds your lives, that for those to whom love is a stranger, will find in you generous friends. As you go, may it be the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Go in peace. And we sing in response, Traveling Mercies, and then have a postlude to follow.
Thank you. good.